Daddy's little girl, but not the girl that daddy knew. Daddy never had a clue of what his little girl would do. A drifter, swift to open up and get with ya. A pocket full of dreams for my love for Kisha.
Millennium Music Mission.
ProFlowRadio.com.
Go! Shockwave Sounds Flow. ProFlowRadio.com. Internet Inferno. On demand and live. Pro Radio.
You know?
Hit it with Fofo Flow.
The internet's audible hotspot.
Shia!
You are now tuned into the Pro Flow for Show Show. Internationally syndicated. Act like you know. With your host, Mr. Mad Max. Pro Flow for Show.
www.maxheat.com.
Pro Flow for Show Show. Wireless phone interview feature presentation. Pro Flow for Show Show. Pro Flow for Show Show. Pro Flow for Show Show.
I'm
sorry.
How are you doing?
I'm good. How are you?
I'm good. Just finished a couple other interviews, so now you're the last for today. So,
ooh, best for last. Out. Trust me. Trust me.
I say the best for last.
Oh, most definitely. I can't believe I got this interview. I'm so excited and so appreciative and gracious for you to give me the time that you're giving me right here, right now.
Oh, I'm just as grateful. I'm glad that people still want to know the story. If they
and don't nobody, man, please. These folks have, we're living in a new generation, new world, everything. And,
right.
And the story has to be retold for our history. You're the first woman on Def Jam. Like, who the fuck don't want to know about that?
Right. Who don't want to know about that? And I'll be the first one to tell them because I can be the only one to tell them. How about that?
You have the real story. Please, can you introduce yourself to the audience? Because I know you know how to do that.
Oh, absolutely. Hello, everybody. My name is Nikki D. I'm the first female rapper signed to Def Jam Recording back in 1991. And everybody should know me. If you don't, you can Google it. My hit record was Daddy's Little Girl. Still is Daddy's Little Girl. A song with Susan Vega sampling. It was a big record. We hit the Billboard chart. You know, we rocked out on number one for a few weeks, and we had a number one single for a while, and then we dropped that album in September, a little bit later than the single, but nevertheless, 25 years later, I'm here celebrating that I actually, which all a lot of people like to say is, you know, iconic, legendary. I don't use those terms, and I let other people do it, so I'm going to eat it up a little bit today.
Nikki D, girl, tell me something. Tell me anything, man. What's going on? What's the new project you got going on? Anything new? What's going on new?
Oh, well, yeah, absolutely. The funny thing is, 25 years later, because, you know, this is about it, where hip-hop is, where it came, why it came from, what it's doing, what it was doing. Now I'm actually celebrating the launching of my son, Fettuccine P, who's got some music out there.
Awesome.
He's put out a song called Numbers. He got a mixtape out called Ape Shit on that fifth from a song called Numbers. Yeah, and the reason why he calls it Ape Shit is because basically it's a little bit of everything on there. So he just went mad doing the whole thing. And it's a great project. I ain't gonna front, and I'm not gonna hold it because it's my son. I'm not gonna sit there and be biased about it. He'll tell you, it took a long time for me to even care about his rap game because I'm not the one. I'm not going to sit there and be like, oh, you're so cute. No, your shit better be hot, or I'm not even messing with you. So it took me a long time to really get into him. So I'm doing that, so that makes me momager, so to speak, I guess. I'm also putting together my own project for the year before it's out. And it's just something for the heads, the fans, nothing crazy. I'm not looking to sell a million records or anything like that. I just want to give people something and let them know that, you know, that real hip-hop will always exist. Those things never die in true artists. So me being a true artist, me loving hip hop with a passion, you will hear it once I give you this project. Have I named it yet? No. But you will probably be one of the first people to hear it as well. So that's what I like to do.
Okay.
Give it to the people who care first. And
so I got a couple questions for you. You know, I got a couple questions for you. You know, considering that you were I don't even know if like, how do you ask a question to a woman that was on Def Jam before Def Jam got started, in a way? Like, it's almost crazy to even ask a question that can like, you know, deal with what you dealt with, you know what I'm saying? Like,
right.
But what I want to know is, like, you know, considering that you're a female and you was in the game a long time ago, you saw everybody go through everything. Can you give me, like, a breakdown, real simple breakdown of your experience?
Sure. The funny thing about being on Def Jam was that back then it was more about the artistry of the you know, the game itself. But being at the label at that time, in that era, it was a little bit complicated, because being a female rapper and coming up against people like LL Cool J, Beastie Boys, even though Houdini and Run DMC were not on Def Jam, they were still managed by Russell Simmons, who had Rush Management at the time. That was all a challenge within itself. And while that part of it wasn't scary, it was great for me, because, you know, you had to step up to the plate back then. And I'm not saying that you don't have to step up to the plate now. I'm sorry, y'all.
I feel you. I understand 100%.
I'm sorry, it's New York City, y'all. They
dying
out.
Y'all
want to know
where
I'm
at?
I'm going to speak to New York.
They better recognize.
But I'm sorry, I wanted to fill your question out a little bit more, because the question was basically,
you cool?
Give you, I know I wanted to go back to a little bit, because I got to talk to all that noise.
Take your time, babe. It's cool.
No, what you were saying was give you an idea of basically what it was like back then. Was that the whole question?
Yeah, you were talking about you know, going through the whole the original hip hop, when it was like about talent and L Cool J's,
yeah,
and all them folks, you know what I'm saying?
Right. It was about the artistry of it all, and not to take anything from today, but what more so was going on back then was information was being given out, styles was being thrown all over the place, people were being creative, people were actually performing. And I'm not saying that they're not doing it today, because it's just a different style of hip-hop today. But back then is where we really made the house, where we built it, where we laid the bricks, where we made the platform really happen, so that people could actually come out today and actually stand on that platform and do whatever they wanted. Because nobody censored us back then, so there's no reason to censor, you know, anybody else. Except for, you know, when they started saying, you know, the gangster rappers come in and Calvin Butts and his crew uptown. You know, they outside smashing CDs and little, you know, little rollover tracks.
The Lord sucker, you a motherfucker. Right.
Right. You're best Tupac, boys. But,
you already know.
Yeah, but, you know, they was trying to kill it and make it seem like it wasn't authentic. But then, you know, shit. After, you know, the Beasties, like I said, LL, Danny, Ice T, even back then, they came N.W.A. and all these independent cats came through, Master P. You couldn't say that no more. It was truly not more serious. So it's all good coming up back then, because that's when I felt like I learned a lot. I learned how to be an artist. I learned the industry itself. I learned how to overcome stuff, troubleshoot things, still get what I needed out of it. So
most definitely.
It definitely was fulfilling. It still is.
So let me let's talk about that original song that really put you on the map and got you a lot of recognition and a lot of opportunity. Tell me about that song.
That song is Daddy Little Girl, but not the girl that Daddy knew. Daddy's Little Girl was that song that got me there. And the thing about Daddy's Little Girl is I had to write that damn song twice. We were out in London, me and Russell and Allison Williams, who was, you know, the first R&B lady on Def Jam. She had a song called My Love Is Raw. And we went out there to shoot the video. So while we was out there, Russell was like, Nikki Day, yo, we need to hit a record. We know you know how to rap, but we need to hit a record. And I was like, okay. So he was like, you need to come up with something. So during our trip, he was like, I got it. He came up with the title, Daddy's Little Girl. I said, okay, that's dope. Everybody, you know, it's universal. Everybody got one, you know. Everybody's familiar with that term.
Yeah.
So I wrote it, gave it to him. He was like, no. No, this is not it. And, you know, being a rapper, you know, your little ego is bruised. You're like,
Yeah, man. He really, really, really feel disrespected, like, you know what I'm saying?
Like, I don't give a fuck if you was Russell, Leo
Cole,
or Rick.
Any of them niggas, man. Right, right.
But, so I respected it because I said, well, he got to know what he's talking about. Shit, what he do. So
yeah.
I went back and I wrote it again. And that's why today you have that big record that you have. And, you know, this many years later, people still put it on and bang it. You know what I mean? Like, I love when it come on and that bottom drop in it. And, you know, you got the Susan Vega sample.
Yeah.
I set that sample off, and ever since I did Daddy's Little Girl, everybody grabbed that Susan Vega sample and used it. I still feel like I did it the best, though. But Daddy's Little Girl,
you already know that,
was so fulfilling to me because that song within itself, now that was also the title of the album, but that song within itself was successful to me, not because it hit the Billboard charts or anything like that, but because young girls were actually flocking to me once I'm glad you did that song. Like, I needed that.
Yeah.
Like, I felt like somebody was talking to me. Like, sometimes, you know, you run around with your head, like a chicken with your head cut off, and you don't know if what you're doing is right because you're so young. And sometimes, you know, when you're young and you're trying to do your own thing, you don't have guidance. And where I'm not trying to be your mother or guide you or anything like that, I like the fact that the song not only banged in the club when they dropped it, but it also banged in your head when you heard the lyrics. So that was a double banger for me. So I love that song.
Well, I can tell you right now, you are like so polished. Your communication is beautiful.
Thank you.
I want to ask you. You're good. I want to ask you. You've seen so many things. You've dealt with a lot of different individuals. You know, people that we can't even name right now because there's too much. There ain't enough time for all that. But you know, I want to skip to one of the questions I usually ask later, and I want to ask you, you know what I'm saying, what advice would you give to people that are nowhere near you with success in the industry, but they want it? What would you tell, like, young women that are coming up? How would you help them get to where they're going?
As far as a woman goes, and if you want to make it in this industry, one, you have to absolutely 100% be you for you. Because what happens is, when you're a woman in the industry, and even a young woman at that, people try to steer you a certain way. Oh, dress like this, look like that. Usually it's a man telling you what to do. And I'm in no kind of way a feminist or anything like that. I'm a realist, so there's a difference. And what I believe in is when you want to do something, when you got to take yourself serious and nobody else will. So if you allow people to maneuver, and that's in anything in the world, like even in relationships, you know, if you allow people to treat you any kind of way, that's how you're going to get treated. So don't allow anybody to guide your career in any kind of way, because you won't have any kind of career and you'll never be comfortable with it. But what you also need to do is take yourself serious as far as like incorporating your business. Find the name of your publishing company. Yes, publishing is still important, even though most of your money comes from shows and endorsements. There's a train going to open my head that said New York City. But again, take yourself serious and incorporate your business. You know, you are a brand. You are a product. So don't let nobody come to you and tell you you ain't, you know, they want to do this to your product. Be your own person. And what I say, be passionate about it, because you have to be. And what your passion shines through with other people. However, your passion don't mean nothing if you're not taking care of the business part of it, you know? Get your accountant, do your taxes, you know, get your lawyer, read that language in that contract. Don't try to be a know-it-all. Don't try to be a do-it-all, because it takes more than one person to build a brand, you know? So just take yourself seriously.
Okay.
You got it.
So with you having so much knowledge about, you know, how the game works, you know, with you working for Def Jam, like, I mean, that alone has a different identity to it, you know, gives you more of a personality. What was your experience like on Def Jam?
On Def Jam, it was a hard knock life. It was real. Again, I was in a studio with Big Dogs. I was on a tour. When I first got to Def Jam, the crazy thing was I didn't even have a record out. And Russell said, you need to see what the road is like. He sent me on a tour that had all of the mixture of Def Jam artists and his Rush artists. So there was Houdini, Rakim, LL. Who else was on that tour? There was a bunch of people on that tour, and I got to ride on Houdini's bus, and I got a per diem. And back then, $300 a week was a lot for me.
Of course, back then.
Woo! Just to go around, my room was paid.
That's good now for me right now.
And I pocketed the money because everybody took care of me. So I was just like holding money in my pocket all the time. And I would come home
right.
And you know, have money for the trip because I was little sister. So nobody was trying nothing. Like, I seen all the girls get got on tour, all the movies, because that's what y'all wanted. Y'all want these things, and that's exactly what y'all got. The dude, that's about it. But no, seriously, it was great for me, and it was it was a gift and a curse. I had the gift of being amongst the best company in the world, but the curse was now trying to be the best company in the world to others and build myself up that way and make sure when I opened my mouth I said something people cared about. So I always kept my spit game up. You know, I was always writing, always freestyling, always being an MC, because that's who I was first. So my experience was good in that way, and being on Def Jam was great until, I got to the point where I wanted to now do more with my career, because the problem that I experienced once I did put out records, once I did drop Letting Off Steam, then drop Daddy's Little Girl, drop the album, it was great. We moved on. We on the sophomore album. And now, while I created, while we completed the whole sophomore album, which was produced by the Bomb Squad, the same people who produced America's Most Wanted for Ice Cube, we did all the songs. Everything was rocking, ready to go. But then my sophomore project came to a halt because, now I wanted more control, creative. And Russell Simmons had stepped back himself and said, I'm letting Leo Cohen run it now, so you got to go to him for everything. So it was weird. It was a total shutdown for me. It was like, you pull the rug underneath my feet type shit, because
right.
I had no idea that now I have to deal with somebody else when you sign me. I spent
right.
house and ate dinner with you and signed contracts with you, and then you back up from the game and tell me I have to go somewhere else now and deal with this. Now, why, that's not a bad thing he did, but what I would like to know myself was to have more knowledge of the industry back then. And that way, maybe I would have made better decisions even for myself. But when you're not, and this is why I stress understanding the business and educating yourself on it. I'm not saying sit and become a bookworm, because, you mess around and lose your creativity trying to learn everything about the game. But just know that there's certain things that have to happen, in order for you to really pop, besides being a great artist. But, during the sophomore album, I wanted to be more creative, and, I wanted more money for video budgets, and they were still having to figure out what to do with a female rapper. So I was
looking at
that. And when my back was against the wall and I couldn't do things I wanted to do, I completely pulled back. And I said, Russell, this is not working for me.
That's crazy. That's crazy. You could even talk to Russell like that. You say Russell. So let me ask you, how you got started? How you get started? How did you even get started in doing the rap thing in general?
Oh, well, the funny thing was, I'm from the East Coast. Then we moved to L.A., West Coast, when I was pretty young. So I moved to L.A. when I was about 13 years old, 14. And then, I was loving hip-hop because I was from the East Coast. So everything was still, I was listening to the rappers from everybody was out of the Bronx, KRS-One. MC Shan, Grandmaster Flash. I was still listening to all of that.
Original hip hop, yeah.
The Hill Gang. That was it. So when I got to LA, it was like fucking night and day with the hip hop. I was like, what the hell is this? They had something there called Uncle Dan, and he was the party guy out there. Like, his songs were all crazy, up tempo. Everything was fast. I was like, well, what the hell is this? So I ran into Ice-T at the mall with a few friends. I was young then. Somebody took me right under his wing. We just became cool. We just chopping it up at the mall. And though he was older than me, still, for some reason, he just was that dude, man, cool. Chopped it up or whatever. We kicked it. Did all. He was like, come out to the show. Come out to this. Come out to that. He started inviting me and my sister and my friends out to stuff. So we was hanging out with him wherever we could go. And, I used to say everybody's rhymes and say everybody's songs. He said to me, listen, you need to write your own rap. You said everybody else shit. And I was like, oh, okay. So I wrote a rap. He was like, that's dope. Well, whatever the word was back then, fresh. So he was like, write some more stuff. So I just kept writing. It was really the catalyst into me becoming an MC. And a lot of people.
Yeah, it's surreal for me. This is surreal for me.
Yeah. So he was the one who got me into that. And then he started to take me to do shows and stuff with him here and there. And then I got more into it when I started to do shows at this radio station in LA called K-Day that was big back then. And they were the only station that was playing any real hip hop. It was an AM station, but that was the station, like out in New York, it was WBLS.
AM.
So it was 1580 K-Day. I'll never forget because that's exactly where I started jumping off. I started doing shows at the radio station, doing them in the park, free, roller skating rink. Well, who'd have known that when I was on stage with this cat named IQ, that he would be the
DJ. Oh, shit. Stop it.
Who would have known that when I was doing shows with Dr. Dre in a record school back then, that he would be who he is today?
Exactly. So, billionaire.
This is all this is all the company that I kept back then. So that's how I got into it. And then I took it even more serious and said, you know what? I want to be down with Def Jam. So me and my homegirl, long story short, hopped on that Greyhound bus, came out to New York, cut a demo tape with these guys who was working with LL Cool J, stuck in the studio, did that. They got the demo to wrestle. 6 months later, I had my deal with Def Jam. You know, lied to my mother, told her I had a deal and everything. But who's letting their young daughter back out 3,000 miles away from home now, which LA was my home, and then I'm going back to the East Coast. Going back there, and then, you know, being homeless, sleeping at the girls.
Yeah, you know how that go. You gotta do that. Hustling.
You know, I went through it. And being girls, you know, God was with me. I'm gonna tell you that. Keep it 100. A lot of stuff can happen. When you 17, 18, and you waking up in a place and homeless people tapping you, and not tapping you because, you know, they messing with you, tapping you, leaving you coffee and donuts. Like, y'all young asses don't even need to be out here. Like, homeless people, I remember this man, this white man with his beard, he was scruffy, but he would always give us something because we was there for about a week and he would come and give us stuff every morning. Like, and we look forward to that shit. I ain't even gonna hold you. We look forward to that little meal. So, you know, we got our shit together eventually. We started staying at people's houses and doing our jobs. But long story short, I got into it and I got my deal with Russell and there I was. And I was on Death Chair.
Shit. Well, goddamn. Now, let me ask you, like, what's going on right now with you? What are you promoting right now?
Well, right now, I'm working on a project right now in my book. So my book is coming out. Hopefully I'm going to have it out by Christmas. That's the goal. But the book is about Nikki D, the story, and the fallen female rapper. So nobody knows what happened to female rappers. It's like, you have one or two out right now, but who's really popular? You know what I mean?
Man, them ain't, man. We don't even gotta talk about them. Right. They ain't even relevant, honestly, you know?
And here's the thing. It's not that, it's bad that this person's popular. It's bad that there's only one person. You understand?
Hey, what's the problem with that?
It's not a variety. This is what the book is about. It's not a variety. And what it is the industry itself, I think. As a matter of fact, not I think, but the industry itself is completely to blame for everything that's going on because they're the ones who said, we're not going to be creative no more. We're not going to stand behind things that we know can make money. We're not going to stand behind things that we think can make money. We're only going to do what we know. We're not going to do anything creative. We're not going to step out of bounds. We're going to stay in the box. We're going to do cookie cutter shit. And doing cookie cutter shit got you just what we have today. But then you have this person that comes along and who believes and somebody like a Nicki Minaj or whomever the next year except for the people who actually signed her. So,
we'll say, shit.
You know,
and who the hell is they? You see, we know who they are.
But, you know, at the end of the day, I think a lot is, you know, the industry always had it to have the female rappers. They never really believed in them. And then when you had the moments like the Foxy Browns or the Little Kims who came and switched the game up for all the sexy shit. You know what I mean? Like, they came with the
love Little Kim.
Tijuana,
I love Little Kim.
Know? They came with all
she
the
taught me some shit.
Right. So, you know, when they came with all of that, it changed it up. So now it's like everybody got to have their titties out and got to have a shorter skirt or the higher heels.
Oh, damn. So they fucked it up lightweight.
Well, you know what's funny? Again, we could have had that, but why didn't we have another Bahamas here, right there, Lauryn Hill? Like, where's the variety?
Oh, man. Lauren. Oh, my God.
It. But can we have some fucking variety? Like, yeah, I'm not mad at nobody, but, you know, they just took all of the goodness out of the game. So that is the reason why it's just tacky right now. And then, you know, I'm older now, so there's a lot of other things that I'm interested in. Like, I'm about to shoot my TV show. I'm about to start, well, I won't call it a TV show because we don't know what it's going to be at this point. But I'm also shooting my own talk show, so to speak. And I can't give out too much information, but just know there's going to be a lot of, you know, legendary shit going on with that.
Most definitely. Well, we obviously, we know who you are. So, the whole idea of your TV show and all the new things that you're doing right now, reestablishing yourself, you know, getting out here and showing these motherfucking females that they don't gotta be like Nikki. So, where can I find you at on the internet?
Oh, well, you can definitely go to my Instagram, which is Brick City Bay, because I'm from Newark. So, you know, Newark is a brick city for those who are familiar.
Brick City. Jersey.
That's right. It's just the way you hear it, Brick City Babe. And then you can find me on my fitness Instagram because I'm also a workout boss. I turned into a fitness instructor. And I know that's kind of like, left. I'm like, what? Wait a minute. You know what? Yeah,
you got some tights on?
I got some tights on.
We will be there.
And you can look at, you can find me on strong_isfitness. That's my Instagram for that. And then, that's pretty much it. You know, I'm working on things, and when I launch the whole project, I will definitely make noise about it. It will definitely be a press release.
I think your story is unreplaceable. There's no one that can give the insight that you've seen, the things that you've done, the accomplishments that you have made. You are one in a million. Like, more, you're like one in a billion, actually. Literally.
Thank you.
Like, I don't even know enough about you to even be able to say what I'm saying, but I just know it.
Right.
So, what I want to ask you at this point, considering all the things that you've been through, starting from the bottom, getting to the Ice T's and the Ice Cubes and the Russell Simmons and all that stuff, what advice can you give to the girls and the men? What advice would you give in general?
Again, I mean, I kind of said it early on, the question you said you'd be asking to answer. Generally, I would say to everybody, be about your business. Love what you do. Because if you're doing shit you don't love, you'll never prosper from it. You'll never feel comfortable about it. And make sure what you're doing makes sense. A lot of people out there got records and in the studio, y'all, we know y'all ain't doing them, but wasting damn money and time because you never ain't going to do shit. Be real with yourself. Like,
you suck. You know
your crew sitting around bobbing their head, and they all bobbing their head because y'all done smoked 8 months, so everything sounds good then. But be real with yourself. Understand the game because it's not a joke. It's a serious thing. And, you know, stay focused. Don't let nobody detour you. Don't move away from who you are, what you want to do. You know, be strong about it. Be strong-willed about it. Know what it is and do it.
You, with you being in the game for so long and doing your thing the way you did it, I don't want to just like ask you for random shout outs because it's like I shout out Russell Simmons, you know, I shout out Ice Cube. Like, but do you want to say anything to anybody that's recently in your life that's helping you move forward?
I just want to shout the world. You know what I mean? Like, I actually would like to say some, probably what people say is corny shit, but if we get a little bit more peace going on, if we get a little bit more love in the hood, but we, you know, all of this shit going on as far as like, you know, targeting black people, that shit is obvious.
Yes.
You know, killing these young men on the street like that shit is obvious. Killing these black women like that, hanging them in prisons and doing dumb shit, that stuff is obvious.
Mm-hmm.
I just want people to have more respect for our culture. I want people to have more respect for our race, but number one, we need to have respect for ourselves in order for people to even respect us. So we have to learn to start loving each other again so that we can get back on our feet and we can hold down our communities. So that's important to me.
Mm.
You know, raising these babies up like people and not savages that seem to be coming up and not having no idea and no concern for life and just taking them, you know, like it's nothing. So I want to shout out to the world, but I want to give that to my people, my black people in particular. Let's learn to love each other again. And if you ever need to hit me up and ask me a question about anything, feel free to DM me. You definitely can get at me on one of those Instagram. And let me just put this out there too. So anybody that looking for a host of the most for your 1990s party, hip hop party, holla. Damn it.
Man, you already heard the affiliations, the connections, the history. All right, so what I'm going to do is offer my extended hand to you forever and ever and ever. This link will always be permanent. You will never have to worry about it. I'll send it to 11. I got you 100%.
Cool beans. And thanks to 11 for setting it up, my people.
Oh, my God. I'm so, I want to hug 11, like, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah, he's been good. He's been helping me out the last few days. Yeah, I appreciate it.
What's the anniversary thing about?
25. That's a long time, 25 years, Daddy's little girl. So I'm celebrating history in that way, you know. I'm celebrating everything that the female rapper, you know, we don't get to celebrate. We don't get to celebrate our artwork. We don't get to celebrate things, except for when you're up there in front of, you know, all the folks in the music industry telling you you're great. But I'm celebrating because I know my people telling me I'm great. So I just want to shout out to everybody and say thank you for giving me 25 years. Without y'all, I wouldn't even matter.
Please. Wireless Pro Flow female feature. Flame on.
Yeah, baby.
Lady. We can go all night long.
Right. I'm the bitch just keeping it live and keeping it hot. When you punk it against head on. Go west side. What? Bring it on.
Make you love me, make you want me, and I'ma give you some attention tonight.
Daddy's little girl, but not the girl that daddy knew. Daddy never had a clue of what his little girl would do. A drifter, swift to open up and get with ya. A pocket full of dreams for my love for kiss ya. I never concentrated on the fact that I'm loved. Scheme for scheme and things that would lead you to a pipe dream. Picture it, yes, I'm daddy's little girl. I never asked for nothing, now it's a string of pearls. My chance is a thing, could I win with the substance? A princess with a smile, but my sweetness is sort of grim. I never fought the feeling that I had to be wild. Cause in my mind, I was a mature child. But I couldn't hurt daddy, I played the role. But on a sweet tip, I was a misogynist soul. Nikki had to be free, you see I had to be me. Her life just wouldn't flow through correctly. Being daddy's little girl,
but daddy don't
know
what hurt him.
But I'm daddy's little girl,
but daddy don't know what hurt him.
Daddy's little girl,
but daddy don't know what hurt him.
Here comes the music.
Daddy'd always tuck me in bed and kiss me goodnight. Say Nikki